joining us tonight is the great legendary Martin Luther King III, the son of Dr. Martin Luther King.
Honored to be here.
Thank you so much. Well, we had the opportunity to interview you back in 1998, and now, close to 10 years later, we're happy to have you back. Can you tell us what's some of the things that you all have been working on over the last 10 years and kind of, you know, what's going on, you know, for the next several years?
Well, I think there are a number of efforts that I think all of the people in our communities, not just the African-American community, but all communities need to be concerned about. One of the things that I'm very concerned about, I must say, is the level and quantity of poverty that continues to grow in our country, no matter where you go. In fact, I'm involved now in a 20-city, or I should say community tour, touring communities, learning and listening about poverty and what we can do to eliminate poverty. My father talked about eradicating the triple evils of poverty, racism, militarism, and violence in our society. And unfortunately, certainly racism takes on a different form today. It's far better than it was, but we still have a long way to go. But poverty just has grown, and it is unconscionable that we would live in a society with so much wealth, and yet people don't have decent education, decent housing, decent jobs, and health care. And I believe that we can use the wealth to create this, the climate and the community that ultimately would be a fulfillment of the legacy of Martin Luther King Jr. He believed in freedom, justice, equality, and community for our nation. And the reality is, when you look at what is happening in communities across America, 36 million people living in poverty, 40 million people with no health insurance, that is unacceptable in a nation that has a multi-trillion dollar economy. So we can and we must do something about that. And I'm working with an organization called Realizing the Dream that is going to work for whatever amount of time it takes to begin to reduce poverty in America. Now, secondly, I think it's important that people all over America become engaged. This is something I would encourage secondarily. We've got upcoming midterm elections. And unfortunately, our government today is being run by lobbyists. The people, the government of, for, and by the people does not seem to exist. It seems to be the exclusive control of corporations. This is not to bash corporations, but to say that corporations shouldn't be the only thing and their interests promoted. There should be the interest of people. The average consumer is getting torn apart because businesses can hire lobbyists, and lobbyists write and with congressional staff persons legislation that is repressive to people. We can and we must change that. And if we can't change what is going on, then we can change those who are in office. That's why it's so important to vote in the midterm elections.
And you know, I wanted to ask you about that. On our television show, we have a hardcore 18 to 49 year old demographic that watches our show. Some people are over 49, others are under 18, but many lie between that 18 to 49. Now, as we know, and even in our local city, we have a lot of people that don't vote. They're not even aware of the political process. We just had a big election just a little while ago, the primary, and now we're targeting going toward the general election. What can you say to the young people to encourage them and motivate them to get out there and vote? We just did something on a television show called Rock the Vote, where we're basically trying to encourage the young people to get out there to vote. What can you say to them to inspire them, and then also in light of maybe what your dad might would say to them?
Well, my father used to say that a voteless people is a powerless people. Okay. And one of the most important steps that we can take is that short step to the ballot box. Yeah. Now, I would say to young folk that folks died so that we could have a right to vote. Absolutely. And it's a very simple proposition for us to usually go from our community to the community center or to a very close distance, sure, just to cast a vote for someone who has to represent us. Our interests are not being represented. When you don't vote, you don't count. We don't have no choice. We got to pay taxes. And what's important about that is having a say-so in how our tax monies are divided. One of the ways we have a say-so is by exercising our right to vote. So I would hope that we would never forget that. I would hope that, and the other thing that I'd say to young people is I would hope young people would offer themselves for public office. The reality is you can go to, at 18, you can be, well, we don't have the draft, but they're trying to bring it back. You can go to war at 18. At 21, you can lead a platoon of troops.
Right.
If you can do that at 21, then why not can you run for city council, which is a part-time position? Why not could you run for county commission or school board member?
Secretary of State or something, governor
absolutely.
Or something.
Many of the jobs are part-time.
Right.
And the reality is the more young people get involved and engaged in the process, other young people will take an interest because there are people who are just like them who are representing them.
Right. Mr. King, first of all, I'd like to say thank you so much, you and your sister and all y'all that have jumped on the television show. Is there a way that people can get a hold of y'all's organization or a website that you'd like to give the people right now?
Well, of course, the primary website is at the King Center, www.thekingcenter.org. Also, I can be reached through realizingthedream.org.
Ladies and gentlemen, Martin Luther King III, thanks a lot. We're getting ready to go back into the show.
I have a dream. My four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today.